welcome everybody to Grace this weekend. Welcome everybody watching online. It's good to see you guys. I just want to, let's just back up a minute to those videos we watched earlier. Did you do the math on that? In the last 14 days, 109 people have given their life to Christ here at Grace Church. I think that's very big deal. So love that. Love it, love it, love it. Thank you for making that the priority here. I love that about you guys. I love that about our church. The Bible says when someone accepts Christ, they move from death to life. So in 14 days, we saw 109 people resurrected from the dead spiritually, just miraculous things happening. So thank you guys. Feed My Starving Children, Bible Camp, Momentum. I just love you guys. I'm proud of you, and I'm so grateful that these are huge priorities at Grace. And so I look at you, and I see those hollow stares. I've been with children all week. I get it. I hear you. I live that way. I feel the same way. But thank you for that work. And it's fun. Being gone and all that happens while I'm gone, it's terrific. So I'll see you guys Christmas, right? And we'll see if God will work here in a great way. But thank you for your hard work and your sacrifice there. We're starting a series this weekend called Choose Your Own Adventure, and we're going to talk about the different choices that God gives us in life and how we kind of have these options that we can lock into, that we're kind of raised a certain way, right? So we're raised in a culture, we're raised in a family, we have habits, we have patterns in our life, and sometimes we feel kind of stuck and locked into those patterns, and we're not getting the outcomes that we're looking for. But God comes in and He interrupts all that. We can go a different direction. We have a different set of options, and we get to choose those ideas. We were talking about this. We got talking about the Choose Your Own Adventure books. Anybody read those like in the 80s or 90s? Yeah, you got beat up a lot, didn't you? So I'm just saying that they were, I'm just saying, you know, it's okay. You're over it now. But when you were a kid reading those books, the way those books worked was this. You would read the first few chapters. They were kind of the same. And then you would get to a point and you could choose your own adventure. And so you would read like two chapters and then we're like, right now you can go out the window or you can go up the stairs or you can go out the door. And depending on what you chose, you had a different outcome to your story. And that's very much the way that God tends to interact with us, is we have some choices that we get to make in life. Some of them are morally right, morally or wrong. Some of them are kind of better best. Some of them are benign, but all of them lead to scripting the story. And God, in essence, looks at us and says, listen, I'll put another set of options on the table for you. I'll empower you through the Holy Spirit, through the Word of God, to help you go down those options, even though they may not be familiar and even though they may not be normal or the way that you might think about it. Now, the Apostle Paul leans into this idea in Romans chapter 12. I put this verse in your notes for you. Romans chapter 12, verse 2, Paul says this, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to discern what the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God is." And so it's this idea that there are patterns in the world. We're kind of raising those patterns. We're kind of taught to think, or we kind of fall into these patterns, right? Paul says, don't just get sucked up in that. Don't be conformed to those patterns. There's another option that comes through the renewing of the mind. As I receive God's love and receive His salvation and grace that He offers me, the Bible says, and the Holy Spirit comes and lives in my heart, and now I can interact with the Bible differently. And the Bible renews our mind. It helps us to think about things differently than we would think about it on our own. And as I understand the Bible is where I find the heart of God and the mind of God. And I find the things that God values, God cares about, and He empowers those to become things that I value or I care about. And I can choose that adventure. I can decide to move in that direction instead of just these things that I've been brought up in. Now, it's fascinating. Jesus is talking about this, and then I want to show you kind of where He's going to start this conversation with us this weekend. But as we go throughout this series over the next few weeks, we're going to talk about some of those choices that we can make. We can choose this, which is kind of normal, or we could choose this, and we could have a different outcome and go down a different path. I want to start you with this conversation that Jesus was having with His disciples in Luke chapter 16. So if you got a Bible, grab it. Open it up to Luke chapter 16. If you don't have a Bible, if you want to use a printed one, there's some in the chairs there. It's page 730. You can use those. Or if you want to use your phone, just open up the app and hit live, and all the verses will be there in the notes and all that kind of stuff there on the app. So Luke chapter 16, we're going to start this conversation of choices actually by talking about money and how we interact with money. And what you're going to find is that God has a different perspective in money. And this isn't like a giving message, so I'm not going to tell you to like give more money. That's because it's not where Jesus goes. But what I'm going to show you is he's showing his disciples the perspective that they should have and how they use and interact with their money. And it's fascinating. Jesus talks about this a lot. He talks about money in the New Testament. He talks about money more than he does heaven and hell combined in the New Testament. And one of the reasons why he talks about that, there's a couple of them. One is because he says money is one of the things that we can look at in our lives. It's a tangible, measurable part of our lives because we can look at what we spend our money on and how much, all that kind of stuff. It's a tangible, measured part of our lives that we can look at and say, that will give me a window into my relationship with God. So when I look at my money, Jesus says in Matthew that my money and my heart are always connected with each other. And I can look at something tangible and say, that reflects my relationship with God. Other parts of our spiritual journey aren't that way, right? So my thought life or my lack of selfishness or how much I care about other people sometimes are harder to measure, but money, you can literally kind of attach a number to it. So he uses it as an indicator into our heart. Another reason I think why Jesus talks about money a lot is because we think about money all the time, right? So you've thought about money already today because money's an everyday part of our lives. The biggest stressor in your life probably is money. Very well, if you're normal, that could be true. So maybe you guys were fighting about money in the Honda Odyssey minivan on your way to Grace Church here this weekend. You might have spent money already. You bought a cup of coffee at Starbucks, so you put a second mortgage on the house for your latte, and you did that already, right? You might have talked about, where are we going to go to lunch after service? Oh, we didn't make it the first service. We got to go to second, so now we have to wait in line at the Melt and pay an enormous price for... It's grilled cheese, guys. I mean, we really need to get over the Melt, but right? So we're talking about money, and it's a normal, everyday part of our life, and there's a pattern in the world that we are taught to conform to. So in our culture, we're taught that if you want to be happy, if you want to be successful, it's all tied to money. The reason you go to school is to get a better job so you can make more money, so you can have more stuff, right? And we're taught to live, I call it the upgrade lifestyle. We're taught to always upgrade. So I might have a good car, but I need a newer car. I might have a fine house, but I need a bigger house. I might have a Samsung phone, but I need an iPhone, which is more of a spiritual decision, honestly. But you upgrade to that, right? And we're taught to live that way so that we're always upgrading and we need money. Some of us even believe this. We believe stuff like this. If I'm going to be a good dad, I have to give my children a certain lifestyle. And we're taught that to such a degree that sometimes we'll give our kids stuff instead of giving our kids ourselves, right? I take this promotion, it's going to pull my time, I'm going to travel now, I'm going to be away from my family, but that way they can have the shoes and the phone and the school and the trip and the, right? So it's all ingrained in us, and the Bible is the same way. This is nothing new about the human condition. And this is part of why Jesus talks about it so much, because he looks and he would say, when you look at your money, you can see your heart, you can see your priorities, and you can really see your relationship with me and how you think about me and how you interact with me. So here in Luke chapter 16, he's teaching his disciples about this, right? So these guys are getting on the ground with their walk with God, trying to learn how to follow Jesus. So Jesus brings this subject up with them, and he teaches them through a parable. If you don't know what a parable is a story that Jesus would make up, right? So he would invent this story, and he would use it to teach them a spiritual point. So Jesus would, like, invent this story, kind of make a point through the story, and then usually in a parable, what he does is he breaks away, and he says exactly what he wants you to learn from it. So that's what he's doing here in Luke chapter 16, okay? So look at it. He's going to start with the story. Verse 1, chapter 16 of Luke, he starts with the story. He says this, Jesus told his disciples, there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management because you cannot be manager any longer. The manager said to himself, "What shall I do now? My master's taking away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do when I lose my job here, so that people will welcome me into their houses." So he called in each of his master's debtors, and he asked the first, "How much do you owe the master?" 900 gallons of olive oil," he replied. The manager told him, "Take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 450. Then he asked the second, "How much do you owe?" 1,000 bushels of wheat," he replied. He told him, "Take your bill and make it 800. Verse 8, the master commended the dishonest manager because he acted shrewdly. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than the people of light. Okay, so let's just stop there. Jesus lays out the story. The master, the boss, calls the guy in, says, "You're not running the business well, you're fired," right? The guy running the business is like, "Oh, snap. Like, what am I supposed to do about that? Because I'm not strong enough to dig." By the way, I relate to this guy, right? Like, I'm going to have to go, like, work with my hands, get sweaty and a callus. Ooh, right? So I'm not strong enough to do that. I'm ashamed to beg. I better come up with a plan. And then this is what he does. In his mind, he kind of makes a decision in the story. He says this: instead of getting the last few dollars out of the customers, instead of like padding another 500 bucks in my bank account because I'm going to be unemployed, what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut a deal with them so they owe me one. And then when I'm unemployed and I go and I'm trying to make a connection or network with them, I knock on their door. I'm like, "Hey, bro, you owe me," right? So what he did, I believe what he did, was he erased his commissions. "What do you owe? This much oil. You know what? Take my commission off. You pay this much." "Oh, thanks, man. I owe you one." "What do you owe? This much wheat." "Take your commission out, and you owe this much." "Oh, thanks, man. I owe you one." And the master looked at his dishonest manager, his failing manager, and he looked at him and said, That guy was smart. He invested in relationships instead of getting the last few dollars out of these people, right? So that's the story Jesus lays out. Then what Jesus does, is he breaks away from the parable and he starts to make his point, right? So he's teaching his disciples how to use money. He uses the parable, and then he goes and he makes his first point. And the first point that he makes here is in verse 9. He says this. Now, this is just Jesus talking directly to his disciples. He says this: "I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourself, so that when it's gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings." Isn't that fascinating? And that, so you wouldn't really expect Jesus to say that, would you? Jesus looks, he's like, yeah, the guy was smart for what he did, and then he looks at us through Scripture, and he says, "You guys should do this. The people of the world are smarter in this area than the people of light. You should use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourself, so you'll be welcomed into eternal dwelling." Jesus is saying this. He's saying, hey, my disciples, so if you're a Christ follower, right, we're disciples, my disciples, this is how you should think about money. First point, number one, you should use money to build relational bridges. That's a huge point of why I give you money. Use your money to build relational bridges. Don't use your money just to get more stuff, the upgrade lifestyle. But walk away from that a little bit and build relational bridges with your money. You know, we just did Feed My Starving Children. We just celebrated that. So you guys bought and packed up over 500,000 meals. We'll feed over 1,400 kids every day for a year, right? What is that process? That is people with money using their money to create a relational bridge. So when that food shows up, and that food is meant for famine relief, it's the very, very basic, desperate needs of people. When our missionaries or our relief folks show up and they look at a kid whose belly is swollen, it's that kid that those meals go to, right? They look at that kid and they say, listen, there's a God who heard your prayer, and he sent me as an answer to that prayer because that God loves you. You don't have to worry about what you're going to eat for the next year. What we just did was we used money, because where does that 500,000 meals come from? It's got to be paid for. So you gave money. the Grace Race raised money. We used our money to create a relational bridge that has an eternal dividend to it, right? Instead of using that money to upgrade, we invested that money into a relationship, and it purchased an eternal dividend. And we do this when we send missionaries, right? So Grace has, we have missionaries all over the world. We spend, as a church, we spend hundreds of thousands of dollars every year on missionaries. What are we doing? We're spending our money and we're investing it into someone who can go proclaim the gospel in a culture that we don't understand. And they show up there, and what are they doing? They're making the gospel clear and accessible in another culture where the gospel is hard to find. We use our money to do that. When we're generous, when we love people, when we help people, that's what we're doing. So Jesus is teaching his disciples through the parable, and he's like, this guy, that's what this guy did. He used his money to create relationships, and he was smart to do it. Because that's what you should use your worldly wealth to create friendships, to build relational bridges. Now, as fascinating as Jesus is teaching this, he doesn't turn it into a right and wrong thing. He doesn't look and say, and whatever you do, don't go to Applebee's and waste your money, give it to FEMA. He doesn't do that, right? He doesn't turn it into this set of rules. What he does is he leaves us with like a hanging question. He looks and says, it's a choice. Here's the question. What would you rather have? Would you rather have an upgrade or would you rather have a relationship? What would be more valuable to you, right? So a bunch of us would have brought our kids and done Feed My Starving Children, right? And it costs money. You could take that same money and you could go to Chuck E. Cheese with your kids. And you could eat really bad pizza and really brown salad bar, and you could be chased around by a stuffed rat, and you could not have enough tokens to save your life. You can drop $200 on Chuck E. Cheese by walking in the door, right? Sometimes I don't want to go. I just drive by Chuck E. Cheese, and I just throw $200 in the door and leave. I'm like, I'd rather have my time, right? Or you could take $200 and you could invest it in feeding starving children. Now, let me ask you this question. When you took your kids to the packing event or you took your kids to Chuck E. Cheese, where did they have more fun? What did you enjoy doing with them more? Which one led to more valuable conversations? Which one do they remember the most? See, Jesus is saying, you know, there's a choice. There's the pattern of the world, which is use all money for yourself, doing whatever you want. Or there's an alternative. And the alternative is create relationships. And the alternative is actually what you want. It's what you'll really enjoy. It's what you'll have a blast with. You can upgrade to the new flat screen, whatever, or we could invest in the Rahab ministry and help to build a safe house for minors who are sex trafficked. In 5 years, what are you going to look at with more affection? What's going to mean more to you? We could go do this, or we could buy and remodel the extension and have sports ministries in it. In 5 years, when you get into your new car, what are you going to feel about it? In 5 years, when you walk into the extension and see 1,000 kids in game day basketball, what are you going to feel about that? That's not a right or wrong, because sometimes you just need a new car. Not a big deal. Sometimes you want to, it's fine. It's not a right or wrong. It's a choice, and I get to choose my adventure. And Paul says, hey, you don't just have to buy into these patterns. Your mind can be, there's a different way to think about it. And a loving God might actually give you what you really long and hope for if you go that way instead. So that's the first point Jesus makes. Then he goes on and he kind of makes his second point, right? So the first one is this broad idea, like think about money this way, point, like his sub-point or that, like his, first of all, like build relational bridges. Think about investing your money into relationships. Then he makes a second point. And the second point, we would call it a stewardship principle, is like the church word for it, or a management principle. And it's really the role that we play then with the money. So he says this in verse 10. Look at it, verse 10. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? There's a stewardship principle, and there's kind of two layers of that principle that Jesus lays out. The first one is just good common sense for everybody. So if you're not a Christ follower and you haven't decided like to let Jesus define and direct you yet, you can take this first principle and it will just help you out in life, okay? So the first principle is in verse 10 where he says, whoever can be trusted with very little will be trusted with much. Whoever is dishonest with very little will be dishonest in much. Here's the principle, ready? The first principle is this. The little stuff is always connected to the big stuff. That's the first principle. The little stuff is always connected to the big stuff, okay? And if I'm faithful with the little stuff, I'll be entrusted with the big stuff. If you're a teenager or you live at home still, if you have parents like my children's parents, first of all, I just pray for you because my children have horrible parents, right? But if your parents are like my children's parents, then one of the things that is going on in your home is this. Your mom and dad will look at you, and every time you leave the room, they will say this. When you leave the room, turn out the what? Lights, right? When you get your parent manual, it's the first thing that's in there. Tell your kids to turn out the lights. Because you're like, what's the big deal? And your mom and dad are looking, and they're just watching dollar bills be burned up in front of them. That's what's happening. So you hear that all the time. Turn out the lights. If your parents are like my kids' parents, I've been known to ground my kids from light bulbs. I will go and take every light bulb except one out of their room. And Heidi's like, it'll hurt their eyes. I'm like, not till they're 30, then they're on their own health insurance. That's their problem. They should have learned this when they were a kid, right? So turn out the lights. This is the principle. The little stuff's connected to the big stuff. Ready? Teenagers, this one's good for you. Ready? Here it is. Turning off the light is directly connected to turning on the car. Turning off the light is directly connected to turning on the car. Some parents are like, my kids will never drive, right? It's connected. Why? Because if I can ask you to do something as a dad, and you do that whether I'm home or not or reminding you or not, it causes me to trust you to be out on your own where I'm not with you 24 hours a day. Turning off the light is directly connected to turning on the car. Trustworthy in little things, trustworthy in big things. That's what Jesus is saying. It's just a practical application, right? That little part-time job that's dumb, they don't know what they're doing, I can't believe I have to show up, and how hard is it to cook a McNugget kind of thing, right? That little job is connected to your dream job. When I learn to work in a system and I learn to do what my boss says, whether I even understand or agree with it or not, and I learn to be on time and I learn to give a hard day's work for a fair day of pay, that is directly connected to me having my dream job. Little stuff is always connected to the big stuff. The why do I have to go to math class? What's the point of calculus? When am I ever going to use this, right? And while I agree with you, right, you probably, I'm not going to be a rocket scientist, right? I think we all see that in you as well. Like, we get it, right? I'm never going to use this, right? The point of calculus is I'm doing something hard even though I don't enjoy it. Math class is connected to life. Because there's always a version of math class in your life. See? The little stuff is always connected to the big stuff. That's the first thing Jesus is saying here, like a stewardship thing. Now, here's the second level of this. And this point is directed directly at Christ followers. Okay? So if you're not a Christ follower, this one doesn't hit you as hard. Here it is. Ready? He goes on in verse 10. Whoever can be trusted with very little can be trusted with much. Whoever is dishonest with very little is dishonest, will be dishonest with much. Verse 11, so, I circled it, so if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? Okay, let's first ask this question. who gives true riches? Well, only Christ gives true riches, right? Who gives us our own property? Only Christ gives us that. So this is now an issue between kind of me and God and my relationship with God. If I can't be trusted with this little stuff, why would God trust me with the big true riches, right? How does that work? Now, as a believer, as a Christian, this is what I believe, and what every Christian believes if you trust in the Bible. We believe God owns everything. So this is the stewardship principle. We believe that we're managers of God's property. So I don't believe I own a house. I believe that I manage God's house. I don't believe that I own a 2008 Yukon. I believe that I manage God's Yukon, right? I don't believe I have like savings accounts. I believe I manage God's money. So we believe that God owns everything because the Bible says it. The Bible says everything on earth belongs to God. All good and perfect things come from God. So we're managers of God's stuff. Okay, now Christian, here it is. This one's for you. This is how this works. Jesus is looking at his disciples, right? Big principle, how to use money. First category, use it for relationship. Second category, I'm a manager now of that money for relationships. Here it is. If you've not been trustworthy in handling earthly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? Here it is. Ready? The Bible says certain things to Christians about money. So it's this idea. If I don't see myself as a manager, I see myself as an owner, then I won't do the very basic, easy to understand, tangible, manageable financial things that God tells me about. So if I won't even tithe, right? Micah says, if you don't tithe, you rob from God. If I won't even live a generous lifestyle, if I'm hoarding my wealth, like if I won't do like, not the complicated, I'm not sure what to do, Holy Spirit lead me stuff, but like the really easy stuff in the Bible, the measurable stuff in the Bible, if I won't even do that, and then I pray a prayer like this, God, use me to transform my family. Well, your family can't even watch their dad do the really clear stuff. Why would I don't know if I entrust you with true riches. God, you, the culture is going to pot. God, use us to change the culture. We want to transform a culture, but we're not even like engaging God's heart enough to have obedience be our reflex. See how that works? And it's not about get your act together. That's not what Jesus is saying. Get your act together. That's not what he's saying. He's looking at his disciples. He says, your heart and your money is all tied together. And so when your money is not being invested into relationships, it's not because you need to knock it off. It's an indicator that you look through and say, oh, God's money isn't flowing to God's passions. Maybe my passions aren't in sync with God's passions. See? And God looks and says, right, this one we can see really easy. So when I look at it, and that's all out of whack, it's because my heart's out of whack, and God isn't going to allow us kind of to express his heart more and more when we're not even looking at this one. Make sense? This is a stewardship thing. Big picture, this is how you think about money if you're my disciple, right? Principle number one, build relational bridges. Get relationships, not stuff. Principle number two, you steward it. You're managing this stuff for me. It's not yours. It's mine. I'm letting you own it. So get your heart synced up with me. And then what Jesus does here is he's working with his disciples. He brings it all the way to this bottom line. And he says this to them. This is the very, very bottom line, verse 13. He says, here's the bottom line, guys. No one can serve two masters. Either you're going to hate one and love the other, or you're going to be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Jesus looks at his disciples and us through the scriptures. He says, this is the bottom line. Something's going to own your heart. Your heart is going to be aligned with something. it's either going to be aligned with the patterns of the world, which would say interact with money this way, or your heart's going to be aligned with me, and I'm going to renew your mind, and you're going to think about it completely differently, and you can see it on the Excel sheet, and that can throw like a flag that can say, wait a minute, maybe my heart's not synced up like I thought it was, because my mind, I'm not renewing my mind, I'm not investing God's money the way that God would invest it. This is an issue you can't really straddle the fence on, because your checkbook gives you away. And God says, yeah, I'm either going to control your heart or mine's going to control your heart. You can't serve both things. And I'm giving you a choice. I'm inviting you. I want you. Let me renew your mind. Come over this way. And we'll land where you want it to be. Now, the question would be this. Well, how do I know? Like, I don't know, because I got to interact with money, and there's temptations, all that kind of stuff. How do I know? This is the way that this works. The key to allowing God to have control over your heart in this area is gratitude. Gratitude. And when I have an attitude of gratitude, it changes how I perceive God and how he interacts with me, right? When I have an attitude of gratitude, I will perceive God giving me things to manage. I won't perceive my stuff as me being an owner of it, right? So when I have a grateful heart and I kind of recognize all that God has done for me and all the ways that he loves me and all his grace and mercy in my life, I'll view my stuff that way too. And when I have an attitude of gratitude, I'll look at my stuff and I'll think, man, this is crazy. 100% of everything that I have belongs to God, and he lets me use 90% of it however I want. Instead of an obligated giver, I become a cheerful giver. I get 100% of everything. And not only that, God gives me free. God lets me buy a house, and I have a roof over my head, and I have clean water, and I take a shower, or if you're in junior high, once a week at least, right? And I get food. In fact, I have to spend money to lose weight. I don't have to spend money to gain it, right? And look at us. We are so blessed. And we live in the wealthiest 1% of people in the history of the world. And this is my life. And God, my loving Heavenly Father, gave me all of this. And all he really wants is me to live generously and to invest in relationships. Now I get the joy of expressing his love to other people through giving. I get to be the guy that delivers the gift from God to the... See, an attitude of gratitude shifts everything in our perception of dollars. Instead of I'm stuck here, throw God a tip. No, I'm mastered by Christ. I'm mastered by his compassion, by his grace, by his mercy, and it kind of melts me. And I view all these things as an opportunity that God has created for me, and that I get to act in and give to. Make sense? Big picture. Guys, this is the way to think about money. Jesus, he's coaching his disciples up. This is the way to think about it. First of all, build relational bridges with money. Don't live an upgrade lifestyle, right? Upgrades always need upgraded. So it's going to run its course. Secondly, you're a manager. You're not an owner. You're a manager. Steward it well. And the more you steward it, the more I'll give you to steward, right? And then the last thing, he's like, let's bottom line it. You look through the spreadsheet and you see your heart. And the bottom line, when your finances are out of whack, it's because your heart's out of alignment with God's heart. That's all it is. So sync your heart up with God, and all of this behavioral stuff will come into sync with it too. Worry about this. Don't worry about this. Worry about this, and you'll sync up with God. I had the privilege of growing up in a house where I saw this modeled. So my mom and dad, they accepted Christ when they were in their 30s, and they were people that were just changed by God. They were bought in, and they were incredibly generous people. And we never had a ton of money growing up. My dad was a factory worker, so he was a pattern maker, which is kind of like a advanced machinist, and he ran the pattern department at a foundry that made truck wheels. And in the 70s and in the 80s, you could work like that and you'd live a nice middle class lifestyle. So I grew up in a little ranch house and we had a couple used cars and we had a trailer that we'd go camping in. And dad sent us to a private school and they tied to their church and we always had somebody living with us. It was always a solution. Hard time, move in with the folks. It's just the way that it worked. And so he was always supporting like other families that were trying to get back on their feet. And they were just generous, generous people. When I was 12, my dad had a stroke and couldn't work anymore. My mom went to work to take care of us, but started with minimum wage, started at the bottom of the rung. But what was fascinating is my parents' generosity never changed. There wasn't as much, but it never changed, right? So I grew up, finished high school. They sent me to college. I went to college. I took an economics course. I graduated from college at 22, came home fully educated, knowing everything about everything. And I began to instruct my parents in their lack of wisdom and the great knowledge that I had experienced in the academic world. And I would say things to them like this: you better start investing. I told them about compounding interest, the whole nine. You better start investing. And my mom, old Phyllis would say the dumbest things to me. She would say things like, "Honey, the Lord is our provider. Whatever, Mom, you better start investing." Well, then I went to seminary and got my doctorate degree. So now I had all the theological reasons of why Phyllis was wrong. And I would say, "Phyllis, you better get your act together because this is coming, Phyllis. You better be ready." And Mom would say things to me like this: "Honey, when we get there, the Lord will provide for us." That's just the dumbest thing I ever heard in my life, right? And so they had nothing. They, even after Dad got sick, I would go home and be like, "Who are you and why are you living in my house?" Like, people were always living with us. They were always paying somebody's hospital bill, acting like they had money. Didn't prepare for the future. It was ridiculous. When Mom finally retired from work, all they had was their home, right? They lived in the same house for 42 years, so they paid their house off. We had no plan of where they're going to live, what they're going to do. And so I, being highly educated, highly intelligent, and good looking, I said to them, I said, "I have a plan for you. Listen, why don't you sell your house? Heidi and I will sell our house. We'll pull our money together. We'll build a house together, and I'll take care of you." So they agreed. So they sold their house, cashed out. Heidi and I sold our house, and we built this big house together, and they had this big in-law suite on the back of it. And they lived with us, and they lived with us until they passed away. About 8 years into that, my dad passed away. They were so bad with their money and so bad with the organization that my mom accidentally found out that my dad had a life insurance policy after he died. So Phyllis got like $60,000. Phyllis thought she was a gazillionaire. Like, she was just dropping Benjamins at the club. I mean, she was nuts, right? And so she was just, "I'll buy this, I'll buy that." Finally, she needed a car. She actually did need a car, so she bought a new car, and a Toyota Corolla. She's like, "Look how fancy my car is." I'm like, "That's great, Mom. Let's put it in the Yukon, and I'll take you for a trip." Right? So it was, she had her new car, and then she was just like giving money all. And so my brother, he's the oldest, so you always dump the hard stuff with your parents on the oldest. And so I was like, "You got to go talk to her." So he got a hold of her money, and we put it in a CD because she was going to burn through it, right? So she put some money in the bank. Well, 53 weeks to the day after my dad died, my mom died. And so we did the funeral and went through all that kind of stuff. If you've buried your parents, you know how hard it is. Like, you have to close their life down, you know, it's hard to do. And so my brother and sisters and I were doing that, and we're closing their life down. And I remember my brother and I were standing in my mom's bedroom looking for papers, because there was no file cabinet. There was like a pile here, a pile there. I remember there was a pile in the basement. Like, we're just looking for stuff and figuring this stuff out. And I started laughing a little bit. And my brother goes, "What are you laughing about?" I said, "How many years did we harp on them to get their act together? How many years did we say, 'You better get ready, you better have a savings account?'" And Mom would always say, "The Lord would provide." And we would kind of downplay that and patronize her. And lo and behold, that old girl, if she didn't die living in a brand new house, driving a brand new car with money in the bank. My mom and dad allowed their minds to be renewed. And they trusted that if God was thinking about something differently than they were, He wasn't controlling them, dominating them. He was loving them. There's a better way. There's a better choice. There's an other alternative. And so mom and dad turned from the patterns of the world and then allowed their mind to be renewed, and they discovered the good, pleasing, perfect will of God. So they thought like this. They thought, it's more secure to have children that know and love Jesus than it is to have money on Wall Street. I found out, I didn't even know this, I found out after they died, the reason they didn't have any savings accounts is because they cashed them out to send me to college. I didn't know that. I never said a word about it. The stuff, you know, that new car, it's fun. It's a cute little car. First new car my mom ever had, kind of thing. It's fun. It's 10 years old now. It's on its way to the junkyard. All the money they spent on their kids going to Bible college, all the money they spent on their grandchildren. My parents, now three of their grandsons, two of my sister's kids and one of ours, are studying to be in full-time ministry right now. Both of their boys are pastors. Somehow mom and dad looked at that money, spent it on relationships. They're still getting returns on their money. See how it works? It's not a right or wrong thing, guys. Don't get into that. That's nonsense, because wealth is relative, right? So I drive a 2008 Yukon. My car is nicer than yours if you drive a 2006 Yukon. But if you have a 2010 Yukon, you're just a rich snob, right? It's all relative. That's dumb. Don't do that. My house is bigger than yours if my house is bigger than yours. If your house is bigger than mine, then you have a really nice house and I live in this shack, right? That stuff's dumb. That gets you nowhere. It's not what Jesus is after. What he's doing is he's looking at his disciples and he's saying, guys, there's a different way you can think about this. There's another path in life that you can take. And by the way, I love you, and so I'm only going to lead you down a path that benefits you and blesses you. And we could take something as tangible as money, something that's on our mind all the time, like money, and we don't have to conform to the pattern of the world. We can be transformed. We can approach it differently. And this is the paradigm, the grid that my followers would think about it in. Okay? We can choose our own adventure. All right, this is what we're going to do. I want to ask you a couple questions, and I'm going to pray. And when I pray, the band's going to come out. And what I want you guys to do is I want us just to be still here for a few minutes, like take advantage of a little bit of time. And I want you to chew on this, like just let God kind of bang it around in your head and your heart a little bit, and let him process it with you, okay? And here's a question or two that you can chew on. First of all is this one. When you're praying, you might pray, God, is there a place of sin in my life? Like, am I despising you and being devoted to money? So ask God to show you that, convict you of that. You confess it. God says he's faithful, he's just, he'll cleanse you from it. But God might surface something in your life and you just need to repent of it. Here's a second thing you could pray. God, is there a relationship that I need to invest in? Is there another way that I can use my worldly wealth to create friendships? And ask God to give you wisdom and like clarity on that, right? Have your mind renewed and have a discernment about it. Hey, here's the big one. God, what am I devoted to? Because love displaces. My love for money will displace my love for God, and my love for God and God's love for me will displace my love for money. So it's a deep question. Maybe you've never asked for the forgiveness of your sin. Maybe you've never asked God to define and direct your life. You may want to start there. And you're having this whole conversation about how to interact with money, and the only thing you're thinking about is, man, I need to start following God. My life needs a new direction. So pray, just ask God. Don't worry about what to say. Worry about meaning it. God, forgive me, change me. I want to know and follow you, right? So where is your heart? Is it synced up with the heart and the mind of God? Okay. So why don't we bow our heads and close our eyes and I'll pray. And then this song the band's going to play is a great prayer. You can pray it. You can listen to it. You sing it if you want. And let's just give God some freedom to mold us and shape us. Jesus, we love you. Jesus, I confess that I struggle with this sometimes. Sometimes I just want stuff. I feel like I deserve it. How long do I have to drive an old car? It's foolishness, God. So God, I just confess that to you, and I ask that you give me, help me to be grateful for your love for me and your generosity to me. Lord, change me. And for all of us, Lord, help us to see and interact with your heart. Change us, God. Help us to drop our defenses and just welcome you in to have freedom in our lives. Convict us of sin. Show us people and help us to discern a better path, Jesus. So in these few still moments, if you would interact with us like that, we'd be grateful. Thank you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.